I don't think I'll ever get sick of climbing. It's too much a part of me and my lifestyle and the spirit of climbing. Even if I couldn't climb, if I was injured or something happened to me, I would still be a climber. Keep going. What's up above me? 12 deep? A lot of people make the mistake of thinking about trying to do a climb at their maximum level of difficulty. And they think about really trying hard and contracting their muscles. But the best thing to do is to think about relaxing. Try to make the climb as easy as you can. Try to find positions that are relaxing, where you can rest. I really like to do a lot of different types of climbing, mainly in just in being in different environments all over the world and across the country. There's just so many different places to climb, and each place has its own unique beauty and its own style of climbing. And climbing is really about adapting yourself to the environment. And a really good climber can perform on any type of rock.
Has probably the finest collection of boulder problems in America, certainly, but maybe the world. Problem for problem, there's no better place than Waco, and it is the best wintering area, I'm sure, in the world, simply because no other place will give you the power foundation that you can get here. It's just everything is brutal. It's something that if your elbows hold together and the tendons of your fingers hold together, then you'll leave Waco stronger than you've ever been. The best boulder, possibly at Waco Tanks, and maybe the best boulder in America, is called the Mushroom Boulder. Since it looks from the desert out here like a huge mushroom laying on the plains, and all of its sides are overhanging. And this makes for at least 25 beautiful, individual, high-quality, desperate routes. The longest route is the Waco Cranks on the south face on the mushroom, and it's an interesting problem in that it's very powerful, yet there are four cruxes. And if you're going to approach it as a boulder problem without a rope, you must maintain concentration over the entire range, since one of the 512 cruxes comes at the top. And it's about 45 feet high with a landing of sloping rock. And if you fail either with your concentration or power or stamina, or simply fall off any of the footholds, from the halfway point on, you're going to be injured. And it's something that it takes a long time for mental preparation for this problem, in that you know that you cannot be conservative in your climbing style. If you go slowly and take your time and try to make sure on some of the holds, you're actually in more danger. You must commit to things and you must take chances. Otherwise, your odds of falling become higher. So you must lunge when it's time to lunge, and you must stand on small footholds and come go on and off of them quickly. And there's a point at about 35 feet where you catch a very sloping hold, and it's something that you're not actually able to chalk very much beforehand. So you catch the hold, and you catch the best part with your right hand, but you must have your left hand in the same place, and you must do more or less of a piano move, where you must bring your hand off as the other hand comes on, and then you adjust it a little bit, and you must lunge off of it. And that part is probably the scariest, since it's when you're top roping, many, many people fall right there. So you take your time at that point, and you add as much power as needed, and you make sure that your lunge is accurate. When it's hot and you are up there, the holds are a little less positive than you'd want, and it's actually a very dangerous solo. It's exhilarating also, because you must concentrate well at the very end. If you don't, there's no down climbing. You must make the end. Part of the benefits of becoming powerful is then believing that you're powerful. It's often that will carry you through a point where if you didn't think you were strong, you may more or less fail for that belief. So if you think you're strong, you are strong. And bouldering at Waco gives you that belief better than any place else we've ever been. This is probably the very best bouldering area in the United States. And you can sort of divide the problems into high boulder problems and normal boulder problems. One of the best high boulder problems is a route called Wyoming Cowgirls, which is a 512 that named after an old girlfriend of mine. And it's very committing also, in that there's one crux that you would be very badly injured from if you fell. And there's, again, it's very sustained. So if you haven't got a lot of stamina, then you're going to run into problems at the very end. And again, there's no way to downclimb. You must be able to do the last moves. So it's let's call it very entertaining. You're always wondering, you're laying awake at night, wondering if you can do it easily enough, especially if that crux is at the top, so that you will escape dying. And it's an interesting thing in that it's worth a lot to make a solo like that. It's worth far more than just leading it. When Legends Die is the best route at Waco Tanks, and maybe the best of its grade in America. It's a 513B that has everything we look for in a route. There's a brutal power move on it that's more or less a boulder problem, which is a technical crux and the power crux. But then it never lets up. It's overhanging for the entire 80 feet of the route. And there are section after section of 512 after that. And you get tireder and tireder. And at the very end, there's a section, I like to call it the salsa section. Because there's a part where if you fall, people have taken 50-foot falls above the last bolt. And you're very tired, and there's one last 512 section a long ways out from the last bolt. And so it demands a lot of concentration, not just power in your forearms and fingers. So that adds another interesting aspect to the climb, and it's my vote as to the best 513 in America. I look at new routes as an author looks at a book. In your lifetime, you read many books, but you only get to write a few great ones. And I see doing a new route in that light, in that it is something that you've given to the world. And it's something that you always sort of consider your own. Calling all the heroes at 513D is the hardest route at Waco Tanks. It's got a very strenuous start, which is rated 512C, and it's actually blows your fingers and your biceps out both. And this leads up to a very hard single boulder problem move and much sustained climbing afterwards. And if you can make it through the boulder problem after coming from the bottom, it's still not for sure that you'll make it to the top, since the climbing is still so strenuous there.
I have things that if they let us bolt will be 514B, and there's some chance even harder. And it's a matter of we'll become strong enough to do them. We will have the commitment and the time and the weather. If we are allowed to bolt, then we'll have tremendous climbs for the Europeans and the rest of Americans to come back to next year.
The Diamond. The 600-foot east face of Long's Peak in Rocky Mountain National Park. Since the dawn of climbing in North America, it's been the dream of some of the country's most noted alpinists. Formerly approached with big wall attitudes and ethics, the Diamond has now become a must-do classic for free climbers. Roger Briggs, climbing at the top end of the standard for over two decades, has a unique perspective on the development of alpine free climbing and how it fits into his life.
Well, I guess if you know, we step back and say why should people climb? I think there's a lot of reasons that aren't worth doing it for. I think it's something that's just got to enhance your life and fit in with other things that you do. I can't be just a climber myself, so if it's not providing me with fun and what I call therapeutic value, you know, going out and reducing stress. And when I have a good climb on Sunday, I can go back to work on Monday a lot easier. That's kind of the bottom line for me.
Roger's devotion to work and family is mirrored by his partner, Michael Gilbert, who is equally adept at the perils of practicing law or climbing 512 at over 14,000 feet.
I think that the climbing's a fits. It gives one the impression of being, or at least rock climbing, of death-defying and extremely dangerous. When if you do everything right, it's really actually very safe. But it gives one the experience of true fear.
The route Briggs and Gilbert have chosen to climb follows a series of cracks and thin corners up the right side of the Diamond. Dubbed the King of Swords and sporting two pitches of 510, four pitches of 511, as well as a magnificent thin corner that goes at 12A, it's considered by many to be the best hard-free route on the Diamond. After warming up on the 6-mile approach, the pair quickly moves through the opening pitches. Briggs and Gilbert have had a long and prolific partnership, and their familiarity with both the terrain and each other's climbing style is reflected by the speed at which they cruise the bottom pitches towards the crux.
I think doing hard climbs on the Diamond too really requires a good partnership. You really need to do the hardest climbs up there. Both people have got to really carry the load, and it's really neat chemistry when you have a partner that you can do that with. And you know, the last few years, Michael and I have been doing that, and it's kind of ultimate. So it's more than just it's greater than the sum of the parts.
I think that's probably the quality that I like most about both the mountains and the Diamond in general, is that it's not just so much the ability to power off a single move somewhere, but it's it's hanging in there. It's you kind of have to dig down really deep and go up. And I don't know. I've never climbed up there with anybody that's as good at it as Roger.
As Briggs struggles with the classic fifth pitch, a 12A corner which he declares to be the best single pitch on the diamond, his wife Marianne has run up to Chasm View, a ledge on the north face that provides almost too good a view of the climbers on the face.
Scary. He goes off and climbs, and I stay home with the kids. I can pretend like he's safe, and I have to see how scary it is. And this way I can actually see what would happen if he were to fall.
Marianne's concern for the climbers is quickly realized as Gilbert finishes the sixth pitch. With only 160 feet to climb to the finishing slabs, the pair is engulfed in a storm.
All hell broke loose. I don't think I've ever seen it snow so hard in my life. Little kind of pellets of corn snow. It was snowing so hard I couldn't even think about climbing. It was snowing so hard that between the time I could brush off a foothold and I could get my foot to it, a second or two later, it'd be covered with snow.
You know, you learn something about yourself when you go through something like that. You can make it. It's a different level of information than you get if you pull off a 12B crux on a nice cool day in the fall. One's technical and one's almost, you want to say it's a little deeper in your soul.
Though climbing 5'11 in these conditions is desperate, the five overhanging rappels through the blizzard are unthinkable. With retreat next to impossible, Roger has little choice but to climb out through the storm.
It's a bit of a blur in my mind at this point because it really was just sort of a survival situation. I just did whatever it took. And I knew the top was close, so that's a big motivator. Very unpleasant.
It's not fun anymore, but there's a perverse aesthetic in it. That even in these really horrible wet conditions, when you're totally frozen, your hands are cramped, and everything's bad, you know, you just try your hardest and you do your best. And, you know, I think that's the diamond.
That's the worst lead I've done in a storm. I've been stormed on bad like that before, but not having to do a lead.
It was unbelievable. It's like you put the arms up, and it's like, oh.
Down the armpit.
It's like, oh, no. It's totally classic alpinism.
Anything quarter inch or bigger was covered with snow. You know, any nice light you stand on, it was covered with snow. Was mainly trying to just do hand jams. That's why I couldn't use handholds. Was trying to keep the pro close to me. So I figured I'd probably pop off any time. I never did. Just kind of survival.
Thank you.
As you look around Chattanooga and areas like this, there's cliffs everywhere. You see these receding ways to sandstone bluffs that just disappear into the distance. There's literally hundreds of miles of sandstone cliffs here. So this is the ideal location for a climber. You've got great weather, great climbing, ideal location. You hop in your car, you drive 7 miles down the canyon, and you've got some of the best sandstone climbing in the United States right here. There's so much power involved in climbing roofs. You're fighting the whole way. It's just a desperate struggle to stay on the rock. Very aggressive, very gymnastic climbing. Ruby Fruit is kind of a really classic T-wall route. It's a new wave route. It's mostly a bolt cliff with a couple of trad pieces thrown in for good measure. It's a power climb. It's a typical Tennessee wall power climb. Opens with about 60 feet of good face to get you warmed up, then whips over a 512 roof with a really wicked sloper move. Then you pump on up through these just incredible tiered overhangs, and you're just fighting on these things. They're pretty good holds until you get out to the lip, and you have to do this really intricate iron cross move out through these hangs. That's where you really start smoking on it. And usually by the time you get to the top, you're starting to struggle a little bit. You're starting to breathe hard and really starting to put out some serious effort.
The name psychopath pretty much says it all. You have to get this psychotic vengeance to get this climb. The moves are difficult, and they're just one after the other. And you have to look at the climb and the whole movement of it to piece it all together, to get it, to have your mind so fine-tuned and concentrated that you get every move perfectly done, and you get to the top without falling. You have to become obsessed.
Grand Contusion is probably one of the best technical power roofs on the East Coast. You find that you're fighting the whole way to keep your feet on the wall, and you end up maybe flipping up and underclinging, or maybe shooting a foot over your head, and it's basically anything you can do to maintain four-point contact on the rock. And it's a real struggle to stick with this thing. It keeps trying to spit you off at every single move. It's just a nightmare to keep your feet on the wall. And periodically, you may be hanging there, and you lose your feet. You pull them up, and you lose them. You pull them up, and you lose them. And you really have to fight to keep on. And finally, after persevering, you finally get out there, and you hit this big, giant iron cross on it. And you swing your feet low, and you pull up into this really tight, beautiful power move on a jug. You're just really smoking. Your lats are just cooked. And you set up for this beautiful move over the final roof, and your feet are just, forget your feet, you're just dangling. You're just almost doing one-arm pull-ups at this point, just cranking like a fiend on this thing. And you finish with this sloper where you're just fish-flopping over, and you're just totally pumped. The Tennessee Wall is a beautiful place. It's a restorative place. It's a place that you can feel spiritually in tune with. And that's one of the main things for me. It's not just the climbing in and of itself.
Springtime in the Sierra, a time when warm temperatures and sunny days permit climbing on distant peaks. springtime trek to Mount Dana in Yosemite National Park is a classic. Classic rock climbing can be found on the third pillar of Dana, an exposed 5'9 rock climb. Classic skiing can be found in Ellery Bowl and the Dana Couar. By the middle of May, the Tioga Road east of Yosemite is free of snow, providing access to the 9,000-foot Tioga Pass. A brief hike brings you up to the 11,000-foot level. Along with the usual crowd of ski bums hiking up the mountain today are two unlikely companions. Richard Leversey could care less about skiing. He's interested in tackling a new route on the third pillar of Dana. His partner is John Monnier. John could care less about the rock climbing. As one of the Sierra's premier backcountry skiers, he's interested only in skiing the steep bowls and chutes that grace Mount Dana, and trying on the trick apparel he gets for being such a cool guy.
Richard, I have to do the demonstration here. Here it is.
Well, yeah, that's great.
There's no pants. Yeah, look, all black. This is the Johnny Cash look. That's good, huh? Oh,
yeah. Despite their differences, Richard and John are good friends, and they won't let these differences get in the way of what they're here for, to have a lot of fun. They've arrived on the Dana Plateau. A geologic marvel, the plateau is an ancient peneplain that has been uplifted. On all sides, the plateau drops off steeply.
What are we looking at here, John?
Oh, this is the north face of the Eiger. I mean, Mount Dana. With the Dana Couar, good skiing, yeah. Deep stuff, good ice climbing in the fall. Dana Plateau, yeah. Third pillar.
Oh no.
High country of Tuolumne.
Ready for action, everyone assesses routes of descent.
Gotta admit, right from here, boy, what an angle.
Don't get too close, boy.
See, I don't like that ridge right down there. You landed right on top of it.
The 30-foot cornices look appealing, but the landing is sketchy. If the skiers can't stop themselves, a 200-foot cliff surely will.
I just don't want to take fall and land back on the Gore-Tex pants and slide over the rocks. Is someone else going to go?
Meanwhile, the climbers went to look for their descent to the base of the third pillar. During the summer months, the descent takes only a few minutes. But today, things look different.
Yeah.
Ah, it's a very steep, lad.
Ah, yeah, it is.
Reminds me of the bend.
At least 100 degrees.
Aye, 180 degrees.
Go down this little snow tongue, across the rock, and down the next one.
Yeah, I'm a gnarly climber, you know.
Richard descends into the couloir. The conditions are mixed, rotten snow and loose blocks. There's nothing more scary than watching an unroped climber, especially when that climber slips.
can't go down there. No way. Mom didn't bring no food.
What do you think about the descent?
That looked fun, but I think I'll rappel now. I'm a skier.
As Richard descends towards uncertainty, the ski conditions have improved dramatically. Now the skiers are ready for their own death-defying descents. Richard was nowhere to be seen until he appeared on the arête of the third pillar of Dana. With only a few pieces of protection and no rope, Richard has found his new route. However, without a rope, it is doubtful that Richard will get very far today. Unable to watch much longer, John decides to rappel down the face of the third pillar and give Richard an adequate belay. Safely tied into the rope, Richard begins to lead the final pitch of the third pillar of Dana. Thank you.
best 5'9 in the universe. Okay, you're on. Like that alpinist stuff. Train harder with closed fingers, eh?
Right. I'm glad I didn't have to climb with the pack.
Hey, I bet you like that skiing stuff better than this climbing, eh? We're even.
All right, good job.
I know, in France we would call that interesting. Oh, where was that one meeting? The crampons, they make all the difference in the world.
Ready for a little skiing, Mr. Monnier?
I think now we go and do the skiing thing, that sliding, slipping, shushing woman thing that I might know better.
Let me pay back Mr. Levesey.
The snow was good maybe hour ago.
2 weeks ago. Maybe 2 weeks from now, yes.
I tried.
It's tough conditions up there, huh?
Well, you know, it might have been really nice this morning, but we had to climb. We had to be mad at me.